Space was founded in 2016 by Tori Williston. This is Oliver. This is our latest dog that I'm training. Carly's going to walk. Carly, come on up. Carly is pinch-hitting for Kelly today because Kelly is ill. Carly's going to walk Oliver around a little bit. We rescue dogs. We train them. We give them to veterans that have PTSD. Oliver was rescued from a kill shelter within hours of being euthanized because they said that he was stubborn. There's some truth to that. Being his trainer, I can attest that there's some truth to that. My husband, he lives with us, will stand up and say, yes, there's some truth to that. Oliver, though, we took him to the veterinarian and found out that he had 2 ear infections, and he probably had these ear infections for his entire life because he also had hookworms, which usually come when you've had an infection for years. Oliver also had a deformity in both of his back legs that we fixed, and once we fixed that, he was less stubborn. Still a little bit, but less stubborn. So Oliver, we started in 2016 when Tori was deployed to Afghanistan as an independent contractor training bomb sniffing dogs. Tori had a new way of training dogs and a way of using hand signals to keep the dogs farther away from the veterans when they went, and a quicker response time when we call them back. So when the dog would go off, it would smell a bomb, the dog would give a signal and we'd be able to call the dog back a lot quicker. And it saved the lives of the veterans and it saved the lives of the dogs. While Tori was over there, he got to develop a very close bond with the Marines that he was with. One of them was Chris Van Etten. You might recognize Chris. He's a model, and he's also on General Hospital. He lost both of his legs in a Humvee accident. His Humvee was blown up. While he was in the hospital, he just wanted his dog. And Tori had a little bit of a hard time with the government getting the dog, because dogs are property to the government. He was able to get the dog for Chris and bring him to the hospital. And Tori watched how the dog helped Chris get through probably the worst thing that Chris ever went through in his entire life. And that got him thinking. When Tori returned home, he found that his friends started killing themselves in alarming rates. I had one of our volunteers who was a veteran, and they asked why he does so much for us. And he said, Pam, I lost 9 of my buddies in Afghanistan, and I lost 9 more within 6 months of coming home. That's unacceptable. We lose 22 veterans a day. Just counting off the people in this room, that's in 2 days every one of you would be gone. If that just gives you some sort of an idea of the epidemic that we're dealing with our veterans. That's how we started Dogs to Dog Tags. So we rescue dogs, we train them, and we give them to veterans. This is Bolt on the left side. Bolt, my right side. Your right side. Your left. Right. This is Bolt. Bolt was returned to a high kill shelter twice and had no chance of getting out. We saw something special in Bo. Bo took, and Pat, I think you helped me a little bit with Bo. Bo took months of negotiating with this kill shelter. They were holding him up because they wanted money from us. And we negotiated, and we pulled the dog. We brought him immediately to a veterinarian and found that he had had a very painful eye injury. He had had the hair that had grown into the cornea of his eye. Then the veterinarian wanted $5,000 to fix it. My mom always said, shop around. We got the surgery for $500. Once the surgery was complete, Bo turned into a different dog, and Bo is now placed with his veteran, Chris, living the life of luxury, too. We will also take donated dogs from veterans. So this is Doc and Maddie. They're 2 puppies that we trained that were donated by veterans because they want to give forward to veterans. So just to give you an idea, we first start with the basics of training. All of our dogs come to us with different training needs because they're rescues. We start with the basics of training. Some of them are stubborn, like Oliver over there a little bit. Some of them are fearful. Right now we're working with Josie, who was also rescued from a kill shelter. Thank you. Josie. Josie is afraid of everything. Josie is probably the most timid, shy dog that we've ever worked with, and we'll be working with her for quite a while. But as you can see, with patience and understanding, she got over her fear of floors. When we first get the dog, once we're done with the basic training, then we have to start the community-based training. Carly, do you want to add anything? Jump in. With the community-based training, Carly, you shy? And that's where volunteers like Carly, our trainer volunteers, we will take dogs out and we will go into the community. We'll go to, if you get your hair done, we'll bring a dog along. If you go to the store, we'll bring a dog along. We go to a lot of factories, car dealerships, all these different places with the different sights and sounds to get the dogs used to it. This is perfect for Oliver. I almost wanted to put your lamb out just to test him, but then I couldn't mean for a really bad video up there, so I decided not to. Once the dog is trained, we spent enough time that we've got a really good idea about the personality of the dog. And then we match them with the veterans. We have a veteran match where we have four dogs and four veterans that are going to be getting together. We're going to do a play group and let everybody get to know each other and then match them up, because the matching is where the success comes from, and that's where the bonding comes from. Once we match them up, we bring the veteran to Sheboygan Falls at our cost, and we train for a week to 2 weeks. We want to train the veteran on how to handle the dog, the right ways of training with the dog, and also different to the veteran what they need to do. It gives the veteran that other skill, it gives them confidence, and it gives them the reason to get out of the house. The bonding is the most important part of the program. The bonding is what gives that veteran that reason to come home. So if they're thinking of making that ultimate choice, we want them to think of that dog and say, I've got to make it home. And we're proud to say we have not lost a single veteran that we've placed a dog with. Once we place the dog, we're not a rescue, we're not a dog rescue, we're a veterans organization. We give the veteran everything that they need. We give them leashes, crates, kennels. We will pay for their first aid kits. The last veteran we placed in New Holstein, we put a fence in his backyard. Once the dog is placed, we cover the dog food for a year or longer if necessary. We cover all of their routine care for life. Cover flea and heartworm for life. If any of you have dogs, flea and heartworm, you have to budget that on your budget. It's very expensive. We cover that for life. And then we just started, because of donations that we were able to get last year, we added the benefit for non-routine care. So if the dog gets an illness or an accident, we also help with that as well. What we found when we first started is a lot of veterans were very reluctant to apply for a dog because they felt they couldn't afford it. And we feel that no veteran should be withheld a dog because of their financial limitations. This is Ruby. We found Ruby starving on the streets as a stray. And you've met Ruby, right, Pat? Pat is one of our volunteers, too. I'm sorry, I never introduced Pat. Pat's one of our volunteers, too. She heads up our grant department. She's the silent volunteer we would never be able to live without, I'm just going to say. She's met Ruby. Ruby is one of the sweetest dogs that we've seen on the street starving. Once we trained Ruby, we were contacted by Jimmy's wife, and she wanted us to get Jimmy a dog. Jimmy, we approved Jimmy. Jimmy came. And Jimmy is what started this as a mission for me. This went from a volunteer opportunity to a mission when I worked with Jimmy. I met Jimmy and I reached out my hand and I said, hi, Jimmy, I'm Pam. Jimmy was so broken. His response was, hi. He could not look at me in the face. He was so broken. He could not go into any type of a public facility. It was too much for him. We did the when I met him the first time, I said, Jimmy, come on in. I'm going to put you in a room, and you just get to know Ruby, and I'll come back in 20 minutes. When I left walking out the door, I heard Jimmy say, girl, you don't know how much I need you. And I walked out of the room, went into the bathroom and cried, because not only was taking my dog, because when they're living with you, you're very attached to them. But then I realized this is what it's about. It's not about me rescuing dogs and having these dogs for my fulfillment, it's for Jimmy. When I came back, the photo, excuse me, because I don't know my left and my right, this photo, I took when I came back in the room. That was the day that he met Jimmy. The biggest thing about dogs to dog tags and Jimmy is Jimmy didn't contact us for the dog. It's his wife that contacted us. She said, "You're my last hope. Without you, I'm going to file for divorce." She let us know that Jimmy could not go to any of the childhood, that their children's sporting events, could not go to the store, could not do anything. So she was doing everything with two kids. And she needed to get Jimmy out of the house. And she was afraid that Jimmy might make that ultimate decision we all don't want anybody to make. Yesterday, I got this from Jimmy. His wife took this as she was getting her hair colored in the salon. Now, a lot of you look at this and go, "Oh, that's cute." If any of you are a veteran suffering from PTSD, you will take a deep breath when you see this photo. And the reason is he's not only so comfortable that he can go into a public place, he actually fell asleep waiting for his wife. It says a lot. When we placed the dog with Jimmy, we did a celebration event, and this is nerve-wracking to do. It's hard, I don't know how you do it every weekend. But there were 200 people in the room. There was pre-COVID. There were a couple of TV cameras, news cameras. There were several microphones, and I stood up here and I gave my speech, and my legs were shaking. And I looked down at Jimmy, and I said, "Jimmy, you want to say something?" And he said, "You betcha." And he grabbed Ruby and he came up and he talked for 20 minutes on the fly. And just was so up one. Every time that we have an event, Jimmy comes from Madison to our events and is one of the more outspoken veterans with his dog. His life changed. His wife sent me a private message a couple months after getting the dog, and something that I'll keep the rest of my life. But basically she said, "You saved my marriage," and gave Jimmy his life back. So, like I said, we're not an animal rescue. We're a veterans organization that also rescues animals. We also have what we call brotherhood events, or brother-to-brother events. If we have a veteran that we feel may be thinking about making that last choice, we have a brotherhood event. We might take them on a Packer game. We might take them golfing or fishing. Or if it's, we might send them on a retreat with other veterans. Because what we find is veterans don't make that last final choice because of what happened to them in Afghanistan. They do it because they come back and they don't have the brotherhood of other veterans. They need that brotherhood. That's how they deal with it. And if you're ever in a room with a bunch of veterans and you're not a veteran and I'm not, you don't understand half of what they're talking about, but you know that they're bonding. So we want to give that brotherhood bonding.
They gave me a key when I first started volunteering. They just started using military words like Roger. And I was like, "What do you mean stand by?" I was like, "Oh, okay." So it truly is a brotherhood, and we adapt to the veterans, not for us.
Yeah. I tried to type something up with all the little acronyms because I didn't understand half of what they were saying to me. So this is Patton. Patton looks very much like Oliver, but he's got polka dot ears. Patton we rescued from a kill shelter down south as well. He went through our training program. Very, very similar personality to Oliver. And this is Rick. He's a New Holstein. We placed Patton with Rick. And Rick, if you look at his Facebook page before placement, sometimes when you look at someone's Facebook page and you can tell they're not going through a really good time, I don't think it's anything anybody does on purpose, but you can tell the posts are not as upbeat as, and you can tell that Rick was going through a hard time, and he met Patton, and there was no question he had him. I actually, literally, the first day he met him, I had to take Patton away from him because he wanted to keep him. He sent me a note and he said, and I wrote it down because it was just so awesome. He said, "Patton sets me at ease and reminds me to live in the moment. And whenever I get kind of down and think, I'm so tired, I don't know if I can keep doing it, I go to Rick's Facebook page. He's posting pictures of flowers." So just to talk about our support. I came here because I wanted to thank you for your support and have you think about what your mission is. If any of you have a mission with Dos Doctes, we're always looking for volunteers. I ask for you to pray for us as we go into our capital campaign. We know we're limited on how many dogs that we can save and how many veterans we can save because we don't have a facility. We're doing this all through volunteers. This dog's being trained out of my home. Any dog that's being trained is living with a foster, and then we pick it up during the day and we train it and we bring it back. So we're at the mercy of fosters. We figure if we can get up